GettingPositiveKarmaNow.com presents Bhagavad Gita for All, lectures by Nalin K. Narula, recorded in front of a live audience.
Namaste Narasimhaya Pralad Lad Daine. Namaste Narasimhaya Pralad Lad Daine. Hiranyakashipu Vakshah Shilatankha Nakhalai. Hiranyakashipu Vakshah Shilatankha Nakhalai. Ito Narsimha Parato Narsimha Yato Yato Yamitato Narsimha. Ito Narsimha Parato Narsimha Yato Yato Yamitato Narsimha. Bahir Narsimha Hiraday Narsimha Narsimham Madim Sharanam Prapadye. Bahir Narsimha Hiraday Narsimha Narsimham Madim Sharanam Prapadye. Tav Kara Kamala Vare Nakham Adbura Shringam. Dalita Hiranyakashipu Tanubringam. Tavakar Kamalavare Nakam Arbuda Shringam. Dalita Hiranyakashipu Tanubringam. Keshavadrita Narhari Rupa Jai Jagadish Hare. Jai Jagadish Hare. Jai Jagadish Hare. Keshavadrita Narhari Rupa Jai Jagadish Hare. Jai Jagadish Hare. Jai Jagadish Hare. Jaya Narsimha Dev, 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 Jaya Narsimha Jaya Prahlad Maharaj, Jaya Prahlad Maharaj, Jaya Prahlad Maharaj, Jaya Prahlad Maharaj,
Jaya Prahlad Maharaj, Jaya Prahlad Maharaj, Jaya Prahlad Maharaj,
Jaya Prahlad Maharaj. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Krishna
Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Krishna
Hare Krishna
Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare
Hare Krishna Hare Krishna Krishna Krishna
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Rama,
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय
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 कैन दे हियर मी एट दैट डिस्टेंस Is all right? Okay. Last time we had completed text 28, 29, 30 of chapter 13. The field, the kshetra, the nature, enjoyer, the field of activity. And the last discussion we had was that one who is able to see that the super soul, the Paramatma, is equally in all living entities and is acting in that way, such a person does not degrade himself, hinasti. Na hi nasti. So this is text 29. Samam pashyan hi sarvatra samavasthitam ishwaram. Na hi nasti atmanatmanam tato yati param gatim. So one who is seeing equally that everywhere the super soul is situated in all living entities, in moving nature as well as unmoving nature, such a person attains to the transcendental destination. And then in text 30, very critical point was made here. Prakriti eva cha karmani kriyamanani sarvasa ya pashyati tathatmanam akartaram sa pashyati. One who sees that it is material nature that is performing all activities, and the body made of material nature is performing all activities, and that the self or the soul, the Atma, Atmaram, Akartaram, is not an actor in this whole position. He sees himself perfectly. He sees the reality as it is. He knows the truth between spiritual and material. He knows the truth about the super soul and the individual soul self, and how this interaction is going on in material nature. So last time we had concluded at text 30, and I will again ask if there are any questions, because this is a very crucial series of points to be understood. So if there's any question about this, I will take it before proceeding to text 31. Any questions about this? Yes.
Sir, if body is doing everything and body is responsible for all the actions that we take,
yes,
why is soul getting all the repercussions of it?
Soul is not getting. It is the body.
Then why soul cannot go back to Krishna?
Because the soul is an illusion. the soul is trapped. And in the next three shlokas, you'll find out how. So that will be explained exactly how that's working. So I don't want to preempt that. But it is illusion. And it is coming from desire only. So we will examine that in the next three shlokas, four shlokas.
Guy has a question.
Yes.
Good morning, Master.
Good morning, Guy.
If the soul is not active, how does it come back again and again? Because he is actually bound in some way to karmic activities. So if it's not active, but yet it repeats its reincarnation because of karmic debt. So how is the entanglement related in that respect?
Yes. Okay, so all your questions seem to be about this, so I'll proceed to the next shlokas which explain this. Okay, so I will just explain it in text 31 onwards. We'll go into that. Okay.
Thank you.
So we will start with text 31. Yada bhuta prithak bhavam ekastham anupashyati tata eva cha vistaram brahma sampadityate tada. So when the living entity sees that there are individual living entities which are in different bodies because of the material nature being active, and he doesn't see them as different entities actually. He sees them as part of the spiritual whole. That is called the Brahma realization. Brahma sampadyate tada, at that time he attains to the Brahma conception. So what does that mean? That means the universal life force energy, Reiki, Brahma, same thing. So the universal life force energy has a source. So that is the super soul or the Paramatma aspect, and then leading all the way back to Krishna. So here it is stated that when a person is actually able to understand this, that all these apparently separated living entities are part of a whole, and he sees this, anupashyati means one who is seeing by observation. So anupashyati is seeing by observation, and there is a shloka, if you look at the Ishopanishad, the sixth mantra, Yastu sarvani bhutani atmani evana pashyati eva anupashyati sarva bhuteshu chatmanam tato na viju gupsate. So he who sees systematically, observes that everything is in relationship to the Supreme Lord, and he sees all the living entities as his parts and parcels, and he who sees the Supreme Lord within everything neither hates anything nor does he hate any being. So this is a very, very important understanding. Very, very important. Anupashyati means to observe and to follow. Anu means to follow, and observe is Pashyati. So by observation, by hearing from authorities, by seeing through the vision of the authorities and actual realization, one who sees systematically that everything is in relationship to the Supreme Lord, and everyone is his part and parcel and not different in that sense in terms of qualitative characteristics, and that he sees that the Supreme Lord is in everything, he does not hate anyone or anything. Bhaktivedanta Swami has explained this in detail, that there are four categories of people who are, the devotees or the followers of this path make a distinction between four categories of people or entities. The first is the Supreme Lord, Krishna. Then there are the devotees of Krishna. And then there are innocent or ignorant people who have no knowledge. And then there are the atheists who are no faith in the Lord and hate or, decry those who are in devotional service. And he has further explained that the Kanishta Adhikari, the neophyte devotee, he thinks that the Divine Lord is in the temple only in the deity form and everybody else There is nothing else. And those who follow that, his system that he is following, are devotees, and everybody else is atheistic or to be rejected. So that is a very neophyte or a baby understanding, you can say, a beginner's understanding. And then there is the Madhyam Adhikari, who is acting differently towards these four types of entities. He is worshipping the Lord or adoring the Lord or attached to the Lord and considering him the object of his affection, of his love. And he is becoming friendly with those who are in devotional service. So that means the group or the community of the healers, in your case. And then he tries to awaken the dormant love of God, which is there in everyone's heart, of the innocent. And he avoids the atheists. Let them be. Okay? So this is where you are at the minimum platform as healers. You are all at the Madhyam Adhikari level if you are following this. You may be at the Kanishta Adhikari also. And then there is the Paramahansa or the Uttam Adhikari, who sees everything in relationship to the Lord. And he doesn't care about whether the person is temporarily a theist, not a theist, or he is devotee or he is not devotee. He does not distinguish between the two, because he is connecting to the super soul, the Paramatma aspect within each living entity. So that is a higher platform. And he has seen that those who are following, they are using their independence, their tiny independent aspect that they have, in the right way. And the atheist is not, and a person who is in a soul that is in an animal form is also misused their independence, and therefore they have degraded by their mind. So it is very critical. The previous shloka we had talked about, that the person does not hanasti. Atmana hanasti means to degrade oneself by his mental state, by his mental activity. So it is very, very subtle. So this whole thing is subtle, and we have to pay attention to that. That the whole situation of coming into the bodily format where the individual is suffering, but it is stated that neither the soul nor the super soul suffer, but the soul is attached to the body, so he will experience those through the body, but the soul itself has nothing to do with any of this. The super soul, of course, is not partaking of our karma, nor is he partaking of our unhappiness or joy. It is the super soul is always Atmaram, always self-satisfied and in transcendental bliss. So depending on what the vision of the individual is, that is where he will go. So text 31 says that when the person stops to see these differentiations in different identities, and this is expanded in Ishopinishad, the sixth mantra also, he is actually in the Brahma conception. So he's saying the all-pervading force, the universal life force is everywhere. So you are actually in that position. Then text 32. Anadvitvan, anaditvan nirgunatvat paramatmayamayam avyaya sharirastho api kaunteya na karoti na lipyati. So anadvitvan nirgunatvat paramatmayam avyaya sharirastho api kaunteya na karoti na lipyate. So anaditvat and nirgunatvat means because of the eternal transcendental nature, param, beyond material nature, atma, the spirit, is inexhaustible. So this is actually reference to the paramatma, that the divine is inexhaustible, the individual is not inexhaustible in that sense. At the same time, the individual soul has a similar quality, but in tiny quantity of form. It is a very, very small spark of the divine. So anadityat nirgunatvat param atma, that is the paramatma, is the super soul, is beyond this, is inexhaustible, and although sharirastha api dwelling in the body, Kaunteya, na karoti na lipyate, he is not doing anything and he is not entangled in anything at all. And the same argument is applicable to the soul. So the soul is also not actually entangled, but he is entangled in the sense that he is identified with material nature. The Paramatma never identifies. So that is a big difference between the two. Text 33. Yatha sarva gatam sokshmayad akasham no api lipyate sarvatravisthito dehi tathatma no api lipyate. यथा सर्वगतम सूक्ष्मयात् आकाशम न उपलिप्यते. जस्ट एज द स्काई बिकॉज ऑफ इट्स ऑल परवेडिंग एंड इट्स सटल नेचर इज एवरीवेयर बट नेवर मिक्सेस न उपलिप्यते सर्वत्र अवस्थिता देही. सो सिमिलरली नेवर मिक्सेस विद एनीथिंग. इट इज नॉट कंटेमिनेटेड बट इट इज एवरीवेयर ऑल्दो एवरीथिंग इज इन इट. And similarly, the soul situated in this kind of a understanding, a self-realized soul, does not mix with the body, although situated in the body. So actually, whether the soul is self-realized, actually that is, let me correct myself here. Sarvatra avasthita dehe tatha atma na upalipyate. So the soul situated in the body is never mixing with the material nature also, just as the sky never mixes with any matter, although it is present everywhere. So sky or space or air, you can consider, is everywhere, but it is never mixing. So the pure element of the air or the pure element of space is not contaminated, although it contains other things live in it. So similarly, the soul is never contaminated, although it is living in the material elements of the body. The 24 elements and the 25th and the 26th are the soul and the super soul. They are neither mixing nor are confused, although the soul is confused with in terms of misidentifying with the body. The super soul is never confused. So that is clear. There are two things. Previously, it was mentioned that within this body, the decaying, the undecaying is living within the decaying. So that is the consciousness which is attached to the soul is undecaying. The soul is undecaying and the Paramatma is similarly undecaying. So we have text 34. Yatha prakashyatyai eka kritsnam lokam imam ravi kshetram kshetri tatha kritsnam prakashyati bharata. यथा प्रकाशयति एक कृत्स्नम लोकम. जस्ट एज इमम रवि दिस सन इमम रवि दिस सन यथा प्रकाशयति एक कृत्स्नम लोकम. इट इज जस्ट एज द सन इज इल्यूमिनेटिंग द इंटायर यूनिवर्स. क्षेत्रम क्षेत्री द नोअर ऑफ द फील्ड विच इज द सोल क्षेत्री. This body, Kshetra, tatha similarly, Kritsnam prakashyati Bharata. The soul is in the same way illuminating this entire body by consciousness. Just as the sun is illuminating the universe by its sun's rays, that is the consciousness aspect, the light aspect of the sun, the heat aspect of the sun, is the consciousness aspect of the sun planet. Behind the sun planet is the controller of the planet or the demigod or the deva. So similarly, the soul consciousness is illuminating this body, and behind this soul consciousness is the super soul, that is the origin of the soul. So you have these three, the super soul, the Atma, and the consciousness of the Atma spreading throughout the body. So this is that difference between the supreme consciousness and the individual consciousness. And the difference simply is this, that the super soul is present in all bodies and is conscious of all bodies, whereas the individual soul is not conscious of all bodies. So this is how you network through your Reiki healing, also through the individual super soul self and the Atma self to the super soul self and the Atma self of the individual. This is how you can send distance healing, otherwise it's not possible. Distance healing across time and space. In pranic healing, you can have a very limited sense of connecting with the individual bodily form, but you cannot do it unlimitedly the way that you can do with the Reiki healing or the Brahma healing energies. Then we have text 35. Kshetra Kshetra Gyano Evam Antaram Gyana Chakshusa Bhut Prakriti Moksham Cha Ye Vidhu Yanti Te Param. Kshetra Kshetra Gyano. Kshetra is the body. Kshetra Gyano is the owner or the knower of the body, the proprietor of the body. That difference, Evam Antaram Jnana Shakshus, you know by the transcendental vision or the vision of knowledge, you know the difference. One who can see this in knowledge, he has this transcendental vision and he can see the difference between the body and the owner of the body. Such a person, such a living entity, then Prakriti Moksham Cha, he is getting liberated, he is able to be liberated from the material conception and the material entanglement, and yanti te param, approach the Supreme Divine or approach the Supreme Destination. So this is the difference. The whole crux of the matter is that the soul has a desire. From that desire, the material body is coming. So the soul is actually not entangled, but it is the desire. It is the desire aspect. It is one step removed from the soul, which is entangling the soul, because now the desire has taken a life of its own. We say so often, you know, something has taken a life of its own. And this is exactly the life of its own that it takes, that the soul is so powerful. Actually, you can understand the strength or the power of the soul. Just by its desire, it can attain a body which is suitable for him to enjoy those desires or to satisfy those desires. So whether it's a piggish desire or a doggyish desire or a demigod or human being, depending on your activities, you get a body accordingly. And once you are there, then there is illusion. The soul is not entangled. It is the body that is entangling the consciousness, the aspect of the desire which is generating this whole thing. So it is just your desire and you're there. I want to see that, I want to enjoy that, looks good, let me enjoy it. Gone, you're there instantly, just in a snap. That's how you descend into the material universe. So this is the conclusion of the 13th chapter. Text 35 is the conclusion, and again the conclusion is that one who is knowing the difference between the owner of the body and the body itself and the whole backstory of it and the all the elements that are present there and what are their respective strengths and what are their qualities, such a person is able to see the difference between material and spiritual, and therefore he can understand this process of being moksha, liberated from birth, death, old age and disease, and he attains to the supreme goal, which is to be engaged in the service of Krishna eventually. So this is beyond moksha, beyond being liberated. So that is an impersonalistic kind of liberation, and then there is the personalistic liberation where you maintain your individuality in relationship with Krishna, you interact with him and interact with the Supreme Person. So again, I will quickly review these texts from 31 onwards, that when a self-realized or you can say a progressed individual, spiritually progressive individual, you know, stop seeing different identities in different bodies because of the bodily form whether it's human being, it's animal, insect, anything. And he sees that the soul, the super soul, is present on top of an individual soul within that material body that is housing both. He attains to the Brahma conception. Aham Brahmasmi. I am spirit soul. So Aham Brahmasmi is spread throughout the universe, universal life force. So there is the individual life force at the center of every atom, and there is the super soul at the center of every atom. So the Paramatma is there everywhere in every atom, actually. So it is inconceivable that even the walls, there are, you know, the Paramatma is there, just as he came out as Lord Narsingadev from a stone pillar. So he can appear from anything. That is your first symbol of Reiki too. That he can appear, create space where nothing exists, and he's there. He manifests from place even when there is no space. So he creates his own space. So he can expand anywhere. So this is how you correlate your understanding. So if you take the Reiki understanding, the Reiki 2 understanding of the first symbol alone, and then the third symbol is the heart-to-heart connection, which is how you network throughout the universe, through every living individual, even unknown to you, because the super soul knows, you don't. So you are able to channel healing to somebody who you do not know entirely just because of the super soul connection. That is the Vishnu connection, the Vishva Kehar Anukyandar. At the center of every atom there is that transcendental supreme being, that is the Paramatma. So that is how you are connecting to anybody, through the healing energy. So you already have that whole thing set up in your system, but you lack the knowledge, and this is the knowledge. So ultimately body is trapped because of the soul's desire, going in a particular way because of his independence of being able to desire anything he wants. And according to that desire, the body is there, and then the karma follows, and then the karmic bank balance develops, and the whole karmic situation arises, that you have the accumulation of your karmas, and your destiny is formed from that. So ultimately, if you are able to see this, then you are on the way to becoming completely free from all these problems of the material universe. So the body, the owner of the body, and the super soul, these are the topics that we have covered. The kshetra, kshetragya, the nature of consciousness. So if there are any questions, I will now take questions.
Sangha has a couple of questions.
Who has?
Sangvata.
Yes.
Does healing heal the desire of the soul? Second question, I assume soul can keep on having desires and hence entangled. Does it imply that soul needs to have only one desire to be with divine in order to be free, or have no desires at all?
Okay, these are very good questions. Excellent. Good grasp of what you have heard. Absolutely. The soul is having a desire. It is a misguided desire when we appear in the material universe. Let us understand that. It is a desire to enjoy separately from the divine, somehow, whichever way. Dovetailing all your desires into the service of Krishna will constitute the revival of your spiritual consciousness. Being desireless means, like we were talking about, nirgunatva, that is without the material qualities. Nirgun means without material qualities, also means impersonal. It depends how you are using it. So if you have material, if you have desires, but they are dovetailed in God consciousness or Krishna consciousness, then their nature changes. Then they are nirgun in the sense of not giving you reactions in future. It is impossible to be desireless. Let me make this very, very clear. You cannot be desireless. There is a desire for something. There is a desire for existence. And ultimately, there is a misguided desire even in this body to serve Krishna and to enjoy with Him. So we try and enjoy in other things. And we are always unsatisfied at the end of the day, because those are limited. So we have to enjoy unlimitedly. So we must enjoy unlimitedly. So that unlimited enjoyment, actually you all have the feeling, I want to enjoy unlimited, more, give me more. So that give me more business is only possible with Krishna. So it makes sense to go to the source of unlimited desire fulfillment. So what is that desire? To enjoy in connection with Krishna rather than in disconnection with Krishna. So if you are having or you are working towards that, then you are in a very good place, and that is constituting desirelessness eventually. Desirelessness means not having a desire to enjoy separately from Krishna. Let's be very clear about that. So if you are enjoying in relationship to Krishna, that's fine. It doesn't mean that you don't enjoy at all. You enjoy in relationship to Krishna. Everything, you start at the basic level by channeling the harmonizing energy of Krishna, the karma healing energy of Krishna, which is Reiki, and doing everything as an offering to Krishna instead of offering it to yourself. So even as a healer, you may be very passionately involved in doing things. I want this, I want that. Initially, all that is going on. And then eventually you understand that actually whatever I am doing or getting or enjoying is the connection with the Super Soul or with the Paramatma energy, which is manifesting in the Brahma nature, in the Reiki nature. And that is everywhere. And the bodily enjoyment is also happening as a concomitant of it, as a result of it. And then working backwards, I am seeking to enjoy the bodily senses, but I am also engaging the Brahma energies, the supreme healing energies. So gradually I am getting purified. So it's a matter of purification. It's not that I have suddenly become pure. I suddenly have no desires. I suddenly am this, that or the other. You are working towards that. And you are beginning to see that the Paramatma at least is in every living entity, undifferentiated. Whereas the soul is a differentiated living entity living in each individual body. So when you are able to jump across the individual and go into the all-pervading eternal aspect of the Paramatma who is spread out, and the inexhaustible aspect, the Paramatma, the superior self, whether it is the most superior self within your body is the Super Soul, and then within the body there is also the secondary superior self, which is the Atma, that's the real you. So you have that understanding, then you begin to liberate yourself from the bindings of material nature. So that is Krishna's verdict. He said this a number of times. He said it's very important to pashyanti, to see. Yes.
So the purpose of the Super Soul is to bring everybody back, or
without the super, the purpose of the Super Soul is to keep you alive. Without the Super Soul, you don't live. You cannot be separated from him. You can be separated in your consciousness from him, but not in fact. That is the difference.
And is the Super Soul also giving guidance? Is
yes.
That how we're getting
The moment you are turning towards the yes, the illusion is being removed by the Super Soul's guidance, which you are then willing to take. If you're not willing to take, Super Soul doesn't care. If you want to take it, don't take it. I'm fine. Super Soul is not bothered about what's going on. He's only bothered that, you know, he wants you not to suffer. He wants you to be engaged in your natural relationship, but he's not going to force it.
Even if I give my will to him and say that,
you can't say make me okay, because you have to do something. It's like people say send healing, that I am doing my healing. It's not going to work.
So
you have to be ready to do your own healing. And this is the whole point. So when people say that, it is an absolute gross ignorance situation. Please send healing, that this is done. Okay, not at all. Not work like that.
So, the other doubt was that if the divine were, that we would not reach back, if the divine was only outside and the super soul is the connector or giving us that guidance through the, would we know the divine if the super soul?
I have not understood your question.
So would the individual soul be able to go back to the divine if the super soul was not there?
First, let me make it clear, the individual soul cannot be there without the super soul. That's the first thing. There is never a time when the super soul is not with you, the individual soul. In any body, whether you are in Indra Gop or in Indra. Indra Gop is a very minute, microscopic insect. And Lord Indra is the Mahindra, the Lord of Heaven. So in all living entities he is present, even in the virus, even in the amoebas, everything, the bacterium. So even if you go into that bodily form, the super soul has to be there. Without it, you cannot exist. The super soul expands himself in the universe by creating individual living entities. That's his creative impulse. And some are good projects and some are not such good projects, because every individual has been given their minute freedom of choice. And they choose. So he is not forcing, he is not a dictator. In one sense he may be, but he is not really a dictator. In fact, Bhakti Rakshak Sridhar Swami used to call him the most beautiful divine dictator, because everything is relating to him. So, in one sense, but it's of a different nature. But here it is that, okay, you have your minute independence. You don't want to be here, fine. I will create a whole place where your desires are fulfilled. So the universe is coming because Krishna said this is your playground. You have desires, you fulfill them here. I'll create the whole universe. I'll create everything for you. Go and enjoy. See?
So now the very desire that brought us here, we can have, use the desire to go back.
Yes.
Keeping on saying that we have to,
not keeping on saying, by working in that way. No, you have to see. What does seeing mean? It's a realization. It is seeing something, touching the reality of something that changes your activity. It's not that I'm theoretically seeing this. See, theoretical understanding is one thing. Krishna is saying one who actually sees that the super soul exists in so many different bodies is that one super soul expanded from the Supreme. Whereas the individual is an individual entity not conscious of other bodies. Only the super soul is simultaneously conscious of everything in the universe, of everyone and everything. So when you are seeing that and you are treating people accordingly, so like Prabhupada very clearly gave a very nice explanation here, that the Madhyam Adhikari is the one who is treating these people appropriately, the fourth category of person, the atheists and the haters, he doesn't want to have much to do with them, which is good, because don't agitate them. And the one who is the Uttam Adhikari is the one who sees no difference between those people and the devotees and the non-devotees, because he is seeing the super soul everywhere. So if you recall, in our Joy of Reiki we had a 1-2 page chapter on this point only, that the Uttam Adhikari doesn't see anything wrong in the universe. He doesn't see that anything needs rectification, but that's not to be done artificially. He's actually seeing this, everything is moving perfectly. So it's a very perfect machinery. There are certain undesirable aspects or painful aspects. Super soul is not engaged in experiencing any of that. The soul is also actually at a distance. It is only the desiring body that is experiencing this. The body that has come out of the desires of the soul is experiencing all this. The mind, intelligence, false ego and the other five elements. So this 8-element body and the 21 basic elements, 24 elements as analyzed earlier.
Consciousness
is coming, is the soul consciousness, but misidentification is a different story.
Mind.
Yes, misidentification is the false ego. That I am this body. Me, mine, this is
so
I.
So now this conscious that we have, which is real, not as in only seeing it, but experiencing it, is from a soul? this consciousness,
all consciousness
now that I've understood this,
it is
also
it,
in my activity.
Yeah, that is coming from your mind.
Oh, still mind.
It is mind. So Krishna said earlier, don't degrade yourself with your mind. One who is seeing this is not degrading himself by his mind. In other words, it's knowledge that is coming from your third eye or wisdom chakra. This is wisdom.
So that's not consciousness.
No, consciousness is there. Your mind is something else. Your mind is an analytical entity. Right? Now, by your mind, which can control all your other senses. If you have this consciousness, then Krishna says you do not degrade yourself by your mind. Mind is very important. Because it is the thinking aspect, the analytical aspect, which actually assesses and evaluates and balances things, and that's how you make a decision. So if you are seeing this and acting according to that, see, there are two things. Seeing, one who truly sees means you act accordingly. If you are acting in that consciousness, then you are truly seeing. And you're not degrading yourself by your mind. So this may take a little time for it to sink in. It's all right. Don't worry about it.
So
you don't
the
have
mind
to.
Mind is using the intelligence to
yes.
make this decision.
Yes. So,
so
then you have to have the intelligent mind. Yes. So the intelligence, when it is misguided, it is going to the false ego. Then that's a degradation. But when the mind is working with the higher intelligence, then it is an upgrade. Yes.
Which consciousness is this which tells you what you have to do which you don't like?
Well, there can be many consciousnesses. It can be your false ego saying, I don't like to do this.
Yes,
that is the default position.
The intelligence is there.
No, the intelligence is also telling you.
Good and bad.
That you have to do it is super soul who
tells you? No. 1 minute. Super soul is not telling you anything. You are making decisions about your actions based on your fears, your anxieties, your desires. So as are your desires, you are making those decisions. It could be coming from the false ego, it could be coming from intelligence, which is guided by the higher self, the super soul or the soul, you can say, in consciousness, in connectivity with the soul self, super soul self, Krishna's self. But the actions that you take are your decisions. Nothing to do with Krishna, nothing to do with the super soul. He is not interfering in your actions, he is only a witness. He is only an observer. And if you are acting according to that observation, then you realize that these are my karmic debts, so I have to do these things. It's as simple as that. It's not a question of I like to do it or I don't like to do it. This is my obligation that I need to do this and I should do it. So there are many obligations which you assume which are actually not yours. Yeah, so that is the problem. You just have to send the healing, you have to understand. Just sending the healing and saying everything is automated, it's not happening like an automaton. It is that you are actually taking the responsibility for doing that thing. So you have to upgrade your responsibility, your ability to respond. And how you do that is by connecting with these teachings in the Bhagavad Gita. By doing the healing and actually having in view that I need to understand the practical expansion of this knowledge. How do I practically expand this? How do I do this in my daily life? So you have the whole background of understanding that there are karmic debts that I have to people. Now we are talking about karma. We are moved away from this topic right now of the knower of the field and the enjoyer of the field and consciousness. And we are talking now about this enjoyer, which is I'm supposed to be the small enjoyer. Actually, Krishna is the enjoyer because he is conscious of all fields. He is the ultimate enjoyer. But in my limited case, I am trying to enjoy this body. And this body is programmed to self-destruct. So it is like Mission Impossible. There's no choice though. should you choose to take this mission? No, you have to take this mission whether you like it or not. And the mission is that you need to use this bodily form to upgrade your understanding to the intelligence level as to who is the super soul, who are you, what is the body, what is material nature, what is desire, what is the karmic accumulation, what are your obligations arising from that, and how you can get rid of it. It is just this only, nothing more than this. So this is how you will upgrade your understanding. So go over this chapter again. Next time we will review this entire chapter.
Simply you said it after 13 chapters of telling us.
But you need.
That's why it's easy today. When
it's easy today because you followed the whole foundational understanding. You have the vocabulary, you have the knowledge, and sometimes we need to refer back because we forget the vocabulary or we forget that instance what we are talking about. So it's not easy. Without spiritual connection, you can't understand this at all. Without being a game player, you cannot understand this. You have to be a participant to be able to understand, because that only will liberate you, because the spiritual energy is there helping you many times. So while Krishna is not doing anything that way to guide you in any way, it is guiding you by being there for you, and just the fact of your connectivity to Him keeps increasing, all the guidance will come. So it's not that He is partial towards this one and partial towards that one. That apparent partiality depends on your evolution. As much you are willing to take, He will give you now. If you don't have the
wherewithal. Why is He partial to somebody else? It's because of this. So we are becoming more permeable to the knowledge.
Yes.
Guidance.
Yes. You are becoming more amenable to it. Yes.
Because it's working out.
Well, you have the practical experience of how the healing works. If you do not have that, how will you work? How will you have faith in this, let's say, or how will you progress your understanding? It is only through practical experience. It's experienced faith. You may not have experienced everything, but you experience enough. The point is to experience enough. And we've always said that once you are sufficiently relieved of your karmas, even if there's a residue, Krishna will wipe it out, don't worry. So you're going back eventually. But we don't know how much is left. So you have to keep working at it. As long as you stay within the flow of the Brahma energy, you stay in the flow of the Reiki energy, and you're working with that understanding towards going back to the transcendental destination beyond the material nature, then you're in a good place.
Shipra has a question.
Yes.
If one always sees super soul in others, does that mean one is always neutral to any and everyone? And in this, how does one form different relationships, some close and others not so close? How does one relate to people differently in the course of life? She further goes on after a few minutes. Actually, I think my
question has been answered, or is different?
I think my question is, there is constant struggle to treat people alike.
Yes.
How to be
nobody,
able to do this?
No, you don't have. No, you don't have to treat everyone alike. There's a relationship balance which how you're supposed to treat. I'll give you an example about this later, how this changes. In fact, Ajay Harith had this question that if we see the super soul in everyone, it's very difficult to deal with them. So it's not that you're going to see the super soul in a tiger and say, okay, Paramatma ji, don't eat me. You know, the tiger has his own nature of his own body. So similarly, people have their own tigerish or otherwise catish, dogish, whatever, attackish nature. So this attackish nature or this confrontational nature is there. You treat them accordingly. You know the super soul is there, but this is the soul talking. You know, or the individual, the soul self coming out of his confused identity of who he is now talking.
So we deal with the body.
Yeah.
Well, you start with dealing, no, you deal with what's in front of you. It's not body. It's deal with whatever is in front of you. It's a situation or it's a body.
It's the
whatever it might be.
Of that one versus my modes of nature that I'm going to. That
It's not that. You don't even get to that point. You say that this person is presented something. How do I deal with it? I am being presented with a situation that actor in this whole presentation is the other person or group of people. How do I deal with it? So you need to understand two things. One is that the super soul is present in everyone. This person is created this situation, or I am faced with this situation because of my karmic bank balance to have to face this. So I am neutral towards that person in that sense. He is only a courier of my karma. Okay? Now, this courier is a bad boy. Okay? He is doing something which is not acceptable, so let me tackle it. So you do what is needed. So you do what is needed to deal with that situation. So it could be in terms of preventing them from harming you or harming others, if that's your mandate. And accordingly, you will act. So it is acting to resolve a situation, to harmonize a situation in a particular way.
Depending on your motive.
Not motive. Things. Motive has nothing.
To get something from that person, so accordingly.
Yes, you will.
You are not going to get anything, then you wind it up like.
No, those are material interactions. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about how you deal with the people.
So first, you know that it's either the right as the first point you said.
We don't know what is right. We don't know what is
wrong. It's uncomfortable, so I'm saying it's bad.
Yeah, so you are discomforted or you are asked to be in a certain position, so that's uncomfortable for you. So how will you deal with it? Just yesterday I had a very interesting conversation with someone who was saying that the Christians and the Muslims are very upset with this right-wing, increasingly right-wing government that we are having. And in fact, in some seminar in London, I think it was, the Indian representative was asked this question that you are now a fascist government. But the answer is that whole world is becoming rightist in that sense, more conservative. And so my argument was, counter-argument was that all these years the so-called Hindus have been the minorities, whereas the minorities in this country have been upgraded and, you know, they've been given extra facilities and possibly at the cost of the others. So the majority is now asserting itself. It's going to happen. It's a reaction. So good or bad, we don't know, but it is trouble. So trouble is going to be there throughout.
So that's so true. As long as we're getting something, we won't say anything. And there's a moment it stopped, then we forget that we got it for so many years.
Yeah, just think of it this way, like, you know, for 2 years you've been getting free healing on the and now suddenly, hey, yeah, my dudu is gone, you know, my bottle of milk has disappeared. You know, I have to actually pay for it. So, cost of one pizza a month. It's too expensive. No problem. Not an issue. So, I'm just saying, this is how healers are reacting. What are you speaking of people who are not healers? You know? So, they are motivated differently.
So, please make it also a monthly thing so that, you know.
Monthly? Who will keep track of it?
Some people, like us.
Who will keep track of it?
A monthly subscription instead of a whole thing.
But you know, the thing is, you have credit cards which you happily swipe for a meal at a 5-star hotel, which for 3 people it will cost you the same amount of money. Well, you can pay your credit card off monthly if you want. I'm not. You don't have a credit card? Just grab your husband's credit card and swipe it.
That too I have
But anyway, that is up to you to figure out how you want to do it.
Vedanta is saying yearly, please.
Yearly.
right.
Vedanta is saying. Vedanta can afford it. No? Anyway, that is a separate topic. We are not really mentioned that as an example.
About the obligation thing, how do you know materially? Like spiritually, we know the obligation, as I said. So materially, what is your obligation? Because what I like to do and what I should do are two very separate things, I think.
So. Somebody sitting outside on the chat here, I mean on the webinar, I can hear them. They have a phone which they... So anyway, that's good. So material obligation, you know, very often you start thinking, I owed this person something, so he took it, so I should be okay. And then you're frustrated because he cheated you or she cheated you or took away more than you were willing to give. And you said, that was my karma. It was my due. And then yet you're fuming at the end of the day, you know, and you're getting acidity and then all that sort of thing. So, because... they've taken it, okay, it was his due, I was due to pay him, and dena tha. You know, you say,
because
I had to give it.
Have a way to get it back.
Because you are frustrated. So, what you need to, if you are frustrated, that means that you are upset about it, so you should take measures to do that. So, I'll give you a very small example. You know, 2 years ago, I subscribed to something called the Mac Keeper, which is like an antivirus thing, but it messes up the whole system, so I decided not to do it. Last year I didn't notice, they auto-renewed it and I didn't know. This year they sent me a message, you know, that we have auto-renewed your Mac Keeper subscription. So I said, hey, which one? I've not used it, I've deleted it. So, manage your subscription, I clicked it. And then it came to a page says that if you want to cancel this, press this button. Otherwise, you press the other button and we'll give you 20% off for your next thing. So I pressed the cancel and guess what message came up? We've already charged you for this. We are not cancelling this, but the future subscription is cancelled. So I immediately put in a complaint to PayPal and I wrote to them. I said, this is fraud because you are not giving me the option. Firstly, you didn't inform me ahead of time that you were going to renew, even though if it is on so-called auto-renew, I don't recall it. You have to give me notice and you have to give me the option of not subscribing. Instantly the money came back, including the taxes and everything. There's some Indian company who's managing this for them here. But so I'm saying that, you know, don't get frustrated, just take action, and if it doesn't, then you forget about it.
Pankaj keeps on teasing, keep trying.
You try it and it didn't work.
He said, don't feel shy.
I don't have any choices at any given point of time for certain things.
You don't. You think you do, because you think your options are unlimited. They're not. You think I have many choices, you don't really actually have many choices, if you look at it. Because if you look at the balance of power and what you gain and lose, you don't have many choices. You have maximum of 2 or 3 choices, not more.
So which of these is my obligation?
Yeah, so that's where the balance of power is, you have to see. Which side is it tilting? Because that you can't fight.
So if the balance of power is with me, I can take decisions.
It depends. Balance of power is with you or with the situation. What is it going to be? You know, where is the balance of power? Is it that I should stop doing what I've been doing very well? Now I've got this new, very exciting looking opportunity which is in a completely different field. No. I have to constantly advise people, no, bad idea. So do what your core competence is. Whatever is your core competence that you must do. Suddenly going into some different field and then you will divert your attention. You will split your power. This is the thing.
So what happens to people who suddenly they come up with this? I think that's what makes us think that what if it happens to us? And maybe this will be an offshoot and suddenly
I realize
I didn't know I had this and then I worked on it. I started with computers and then started doing something creative and then went on there and never imagined I would do something with.
No, but if you look back, your history would, if you were in the creative aspect, you would have had a longer history with that. Absolutely.
Sometimes that's the doubt I think that in the younger ones I think
not that way. I know what I have. I know my strengths and weaknesses and how I should act. But then again, is this my duty? Materially. Spiritually, is it?
It is your duty to what?
I don't know, saying obligations.
No, I think that is not exactly the right question. That's not exactly that. Is it my duty to do what I like to do? That's what you're asking. I mean, that's a very strange question in one sense. You'd like to be a musician, and is that my duty? Yes, it is. What else? I mean, don't complicate it. It's as simple as that. That this is what you're driven to do. This is what you're talented for. I'm not saying you're unlimitedly talented, although people around you may be telling you how great you are. But your teacher will pull you down a couple of pegs and say you're not so great because you need to learn more. So that's fine. But at least you know that you are going in this direction. You're committed to it, or at least you have a passionate interest where you can pursue it. So that's where you should do. And you know, those are ultimately irrelevant. Whether you are a musician, or whether you are an artist, or whether you are a cook, or whether you are a teacher, ultimately it matters where you are going internally. Those are external supports to your internal strengths. Look at it this way. I am doing this so that I can earn a living. Basically, why is anybody working? Is to earn a living, right? To support their life. Because without working, you have the example that without working, you can't really support your life. Unless you have inherited some money, then that goes in a different direction and actually creates greater problems. Because then you are purposeless very often. So you must have a purpose. The most important thing is to have a purpose. And then you may have a material purpose, and then distinguish between material purpose and your spiritual purpose, and how to merge the two, or to have them working harmoniously together. That is the only thing, ultimately. So if you are working with your material purpose and your spiritual purpose harmoniously, that's all there is to life. There's nothing more. So then you become more and more detached. Because like, you know, you cannot endlessly heal your body. Whoever told you that your body will last out forever, or without pain, or without any ailment? It's not. It's designed to self-destruct at some point. Why don't you understand that? And then work accordingly. So what is more important? So the consciousness that never changes, although the body constantly changes. And that consciousness is linked to the Atma, who is linked to the Paramatma. So the Atma and the Paramatma are constant, and consciousness as a derivative or an expanded form of the Atma is there in the body. But it will get wound up and leave when the body is no more habitable for that consciousness. Then you go to another body. So whatever you've gained, whatever accolades you've gained, this is a very temporary. It's only this one body. Once this body is over, finished, nobody knows you. How many of you remember your great-grandfather, even seen them, or even know their names? Go back, another one, great-great-grandfather, we have no idea. Then, who cares? And when great-great-great-grandfather was there, he was saying, no, I want, you know, I shall be known. Apni nishani hai. All that. Oh, nishani kahan gayi? It's disappeared. You put a building with your name on it. You put a statue outside on which all the pigeons sit and crack, you know. So, isn't it? Then sit on your head and on the statue, and then you get guano over there, huh? Yeah, that's bird poo is guano. Oh, guano, whatever. Even bats will come at night. So, what is the use of it all? So, the point is, it is a losing game. Understand, you've been dealt cards where you are going to lose. And the house always wins. Huh? The casino always wins. So, the material casino is winning. You are losing. So, now get out of this gambling business. This gambling and speculation is the biggest problem.
Best put, I think, the whole.
I'm not sure if that's best, but this is something amusing.
So how we deal with is more important than what is the action, or how you deal with it is more important?
Both. I mean, the action is not separate from how you deal with something. How are they separated? They are not separated. They are the same. So how you deal with something comes again about your desiring, your thinking, your willing, your planning, and then executing. And that's destiny. That's how you create destiny. Okay? So I think we'll conclude here. And more questions?
One from Shukra.
Yes.
Sir mentioned on Thursday class that we should send healing, that Reiki guides us and talks to us through people around us.
Yeah. I
that means
say that.
Being able to connect to a super soul level, and if we do that, even if we are dealing with people differently, we will still be connecting to super soul level simultaneously.
Yes, of course. If you are just asking, you know, Reiki to speak through others, because the super soul is there in everyone, and the conversation may swing to a place where you would be getting some guidance. It is up to you to take that guidance. And sometimes the guidance may take you to a place which is uncomfortable, then you'll say, Reiki ne marwa diya. I've been let down. But it's not so, because then 10 days or 10 weeks later you'll realize that this is so much better for me now. So what appears to be difficult and hard in the beginning is actually can be very good for you later on. So study this chapter 13 again, and we will review the whole chapter. More questions. I expect you to have more questions. You had a question?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Sir, do we really need to connect with the super soul?
You are needing to connect with this understanding that the super soul exists everywhere. You are already connected when you are initiated. But you have to be able to see this within yourself and others also, at least theoretically. And then your behavior, if you change your behavior according to that understanding, either naturally or through guidance or a combination of the two, that this is how I should behave towards people, then the first point is that you will respect them. That is the fifth principle of Reiki. So that fifth principle of Reiki embodies this chapter 13 completely. Just for today, I shall respect myself, my teachers, my elders, and all living entities. This is exactly what chapter 13 is all about, that you are seeing all as respectable. And what is respectable? Not the individual. It's the super soul. Because you could be a rascal, I don't know. So respect, because the super soul is present in all living entities. So respect can be in a comfortable or a positive zone, or it can be an uncomfortable and negative zone, such as being faced by a threat through an animal or a person, or getting a positive feedback or positive inputs from other people. So, but the super soul remains the same. He's not participating in any of this. But when you connect with the super soul, the entity in front of you also gets somehow upgraded, which is why that when a spiritualist is there in a gathering, even unknown to the people, there is a change in their demeanor. Even they do not know this person is spiritual or connecting to us like that. Their demeanor changes. That is the influence of the spiritual. Okay. More than analyzing this and examining it, you need to work practically hands-on. So understand the super soul is there even in all situations that face you. And with that respect towards the super soul, you take actions. But appropriate according to the situation that you are facing, or the person is presenting you, or the individual entity is presenting you, you will be in a stronger position. Krishna is telling Arjun to kill the people on the battlefield, all his relatives. It's not that Krishna has forgotten that super soul is everywhere. So respect doesn't mean I shan't take action what I'm supposed to take in the pursuance of my duty and my obligations. I must take it, even if it is for a military man to kill the enemy. Because earlier Arjun was giving the arguments how I can kill, scriptures are saying is very bad. So Krishna is saying you are quoting scriptures like a wise person, but you are foolish because you don't understand it. Because nobody is dying. But you are dealing with the situation. There's no other way to deal with it, you deal with it this way. Okay?
Sir, you said that the soul is connected to the super soul at a
different level. No, I never said that. Don't assume I said things. Super soul is always connected to the soul.
Okay.
Or the soul is always connected because the super soul is the origin.
Yes.
Then, of the soul.
What?
You have the attunement connection, which. Yeah, you have, it is a two-way connection now.
Okay.
That you are actually able to interact directly with the super soul through the Brahma energy. Okay. Last question.
No questions. Okay. Vacation to Bimmi of the class says, good morning, Master, and okay. Leela family, and Chitra is grateful.
All right. Okay, we will conclude at this chapter 13. We have completed this chapter. Text 35 we have covered from 31 to 35 today. Next time we will review this chapter, and as I said, I expect you to have some questions. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
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 You've been listening to Nalin K. Narula on Getting Positive Karma Now.com.